Hey, in this tutorial, we're going to deal with preparation for space. Basically, you want to get a telescope up to view the stars so that you can get a look at the star map and start researching these planets. This leads to a lot of problems, and you need to learn how to deal with a lot of things very quickly, which makes this a little bit of a high learning curve dealing with space. So first up, to actually use a telescope, you need to realize that its viewpoint is right here, basically straight above this left-hand side of the telescope. And then you need to have 5 tiles to the left of that and 5 tiles to the right of that open to space. Otherwise, this will not function or function at reduced capacity, depending on how much available tiles there are to actually see out. Now, as well as that, you also need to give it power and you need to provide oxygen. Whatever duplicates are going to be in there are going to need an oxygen supply. Even if they're in exosuits, they still need oxygen. But the problem with setting one of these up and leaving it open to space is, well, meteors are going to fall down on top of it. Regolith is going to fall on top of it. It's going to end up either overheating or getting destroyed. You're going to have to keep repairing it or demolishing it and repairing it. A piece of advice, if a device overheats, don't repair it. Demolish it first, then replace it. If you repair an overheated device, it still keeps all its previous heat and will just immediately start overheating again the moment you finish repairing it. So, to prevent this getting destroyed by meteors, the most standard solution is to use bunker doors. Now, there are several ghetto ways you can do this. You can manually turn them on and off yourself. There's lots of ways, but most of them require some sort of input from yourself. So we want to automate the opening and closing of these doors. So to do that, we're going to need to bring in another piece of tech. You find it under automation. It's the space scanner. And this is the space scanner here. The space scanner is even more complicated than the telescope because it also has a view radius. Not just that, it needs this cone here, this exact cone from this line up here all the way down in that exact shape. If any tile inside this space is occupied by, say, a brick, regolith, a closed door, anything like that, it will interfere with the scanner's ability to detect. One scanner can detect meteorites incoming at, I believe, 34 seconds? 32 or 34 seconds. Out. That's assuming the scanner has 100% coverage. And by 100% coverage, I mean empty space around it like this. Now, one thing to note is that empty space has to actually exist. For example, the map literally stops existing at this point. So if I was to move this space scanner up, say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 squares, it would actually start to decrease in efficiency because the outer edge of its cone of view would be in an area that doesn't exist, and since it doesn't exist, the cone doesn't exist, so its scanner radius doesn't exist, and it will have degraded functionality. So don't put these right up against the edge of the map, or they just won't work very well at all. Another problem is you can't put them anywhere near any machines. Anything within 15 tiles of this will cause interference, pretty much. Not quite anything. Telescopes can function near it just fine, but say accretuners, pumps, pretty much anything. You're really wanting to keep these away from everything, otherwise the interference causes problems. Except for bunker doors. They don't seem to mind giant bunker doors. Well, as long as they're open. Now, another problem we're going to experience, though, is, well, even if we do automate the opening and closing of the bunker doors, we still have to deal with the regolith that's going to fall down. Because that regolith is instantly going to fall down and, well, block the scanner radius, for one, and more importantly, it's going to land on top of the space scanner and cause it to overheat. This regolith comes down at about 300 plus degrees. So, to prevent this from overheating, we need to stop the regolith falling on it, and that's where mesh tiles and airflow tiles come in. These tiles are actually transparent as far as space scanners are concerned. Space scanners can see right through them with absolutely no degradation of service. The exact same with telescopes. Telescopes can also see through airflow and mesh tiles with absolutely no degradation of service. This makes them very useful in actually building an automated setup to deal with all these problems. An even more important feature of them as well is airflow tiles and mesh tiles don't actually have any thermal conductivity of their own. They take on the same amount of thermal conductivity as whatever material is occupying the same space as them. So if there's, say, water in a mesh tile, the mesh tile has the conductivity of water. If there's hydrogen in an airflow tile, it has that conductivity. If they're in vacuum, they have no conductivity. In other words, you can put boiling hot regolith on top of this mesh tile and it will have absolutely zero effect on its actual temperature. So it's a perfect insulator in space, both of these. Alright, so the design I've come up with to deal with all these problems and just give you an automated solution is this here. It's four mining drills, all turned on their side, and each one can actually clear the regolith for the drill on the left of it. So each one of these can clear enough space to make sure that any regolith that falls down here immediately gets removed. Now, the reason this will work is because we're right at the edge of the map. That means only two tiles of regolith can possibly accumulate. That is the worst that can possibly happen. No more than two can actually collect. So after a meteor shower, when these doors open, the regolith is going to fall right down here. And that regolith will only be two tiles high. That's the maximum it can reach. And because it's only two tiles high, it can't actually touch the mining drills. Because we've got to worry about the mining drills overheating as well. This way, since the regolith can lead up to here, they're safe, no chance of a heat transfer. As well as that, any regolith that falls on top, like this stuff here, can't transfer heat into the mesh tiles, because they are perfect insulators in a vacuum. So this ensures that the drills are protected from the heat, and the regolith doesn't touch them in any way. The only way the regolith can actually touch them, but can't actually, is when it falls down here, and passes through the same square as the mining drill. But falling regolith and sand works on pretty much the same mechanics as falling water or liquids. They don't interact with anything until they hit a solid surface. So it will pass straight through the mining drill area without actually transferring any heat. This is exactly what we want. Oh, and we have incoming meteors. Okay, so you see here the network quality is, scan quality is 100% because we have full absolute coverage of the sky. But you'll notice that the scan network quality here tells you that's basically the combined scanning effectiveness of your entire network. Each scanner you have with 100% scan quality will give you a 17% scan network quality, because these devices network together no matter where they are. So they basically share telemetry, so to speak, to detect the incoming meteors, which is good and slightly annoying. One of the problems we have here is this is how they actually detect the meteor showers. They basically will detect it somewhere between, with one scanner, somewhere between 34 to 200 seconds out. Which means when the meteors are 200 seconds out, the computer rolls a dice and decides, oh, you don't spot it. Then at 199 seconds, it rolls another dice, 198, 197, until it's either detected or it counts all the way down to 34 seconds, at which point it will definitely detect it. Unfortunately, this causes a problem. These bunker doors up here, according to the developer's notes, take 38.2 seconds to complete their animation. And until they've completed their animation, they're not considered to have either closed or opened. So an open door that starts closing will be classified as open until 38.2 seconds later, when the animation completes. This leaves us the potential for an actual meteor or two to sneak through and cause us with the need to do maintenance, which we kind of trying to avoid here. So we're going to need to build two space scanners. With two space scanners enabled, that will actually improve the scan or quality to 33%. So at 33%, that means we will detect incoming meteors at 67 seconds out, which means we will definitely have time to close the doors. See? That's exactly what I was talking about. Since I only had one open, since I only had one scanner active, meteors were able to sneak through and damage it. That's actually perfect timing. So, you definitely need two scanners to be 100% perfectly safe from meteor strikes. But once you have two of them up and running, you will always detect them well in advance. Now, with that said, there is currently a bug, I believe, with bunker doors, where an unwatched bunker door can potentially not accept the automation signal and not activate or close. Which is, I haven't seen it myself personally. Well, personally I haven't seen it, but supposedly it can happen. So it is something to be aware of. But I assume they're going to patch that out or fix it at some point in the future. And worst case scenario, this is the best we've got right now. Okay, so what you'll notice here though is all this regolith here is only accumulating two tiles high. That's because we've built it that way. And now it's going to, when the doors open here in a moment, you'll see it fall down, and we'll actually, I'll slow it down a bit so we can, as you can see, all the mining drills are taking care of the problem. And we'll have a look at the space scanner over here. You'll notice its scan quality is actually zero. It's blocked by that much regolith. Its scan quality is nothing. But as the mining drills get to work and remove everything, the scan quality keeps going up and up, and the network quality is already at 43 seconds, so we're already safe from the next meteor shower, assuming another one comes. Okay, there is one other problem you have to deal with. Mining drills do generate heat when they're active. When they're active like this, mining the regolith, they will actually generate their own heat, and since they're in a vacuum, there's nowhere that heat to go. So what I've done here is I've run a bunch of pipes all along the background. There's just one piece of radiant piping behind all the drills. However, on its own, this will not work. For example, if we look at the temperature over here, you'll see all these drills on the right are all in a nice balmy 30 degrees, all about the same temperature, yeah, 29.9, 29.9 all the way along. And these ones over here are too hot. These ones are actually a little bit overheated. It's 48 degrees, this one is 41, this one's 45. Let's take this 48 degree one. The reason these ones are not cooling down like these ones are is these ones don't have a medium to transfer the temperature. If you look over here, you'll notice there's a temperature shift plate. You don't need temperature shift plates. You could use a drywall piece either. But it has a drywall piece or a temperature shift plate behind it to prevent any liquids evaporating. And then at the bottom there, you'll notice the petroleum liquid, 339 grams. Basically, I cracked open a pipe here and let a drop of liquid fall on this tile. And so long as there's a backing behind it to prevent it from evaporating into space, it will work just fine. It will act as a medium. So which one of these was the hottest again? This one, 48. So this one does not have any liquid behind it just yet. So what we're going to do is deconstruct this radiant pipe. And you can watch all the liquid blob all over the place, which even cools the robo miner a little bit to start, which is great. And then if we hook back up the piping again, another piece of radiant pipe. Liquid starts flowing, and the robo miner starts to cool even more. And very shortly, it'll be down to 29.9 degrees. This ensures that the robo miners stay cool. Keeps them from ever overheating. You should have to do, with two space scanners, the robo miners, and some piping back here with a little drop of liquid on every single tile, you will have to do zero maintenance on maintaining this. It will effectively destroy all the regolith that falls down and protect your space scanners and allow your telescope to work. However, there's another problem. The problem is these are, well, that's 16 bunker doors, each one drawing 120 watts for 38.2 seconds, which is a big power draw. So to take care of that, so a quick jump over here to my actual live playthrough, and what we're going to take advantage of here is we have automated a way to clear the regolith and get ourselves access to the sky, which has given us access to light, which has given us access to solar panels, which means we can use that to generate the extra electricity we're going to need to, well, to power all these robo miners, these doors, and actually supplement our power supply by quite a bit. Now, these solar panels are arranged in a triangular formation or a pyramid formation, whatever way you want to refer to it. This is the most efficient way to use them. Someone did some testing, and it's basically to do with the way light comes in. For example, if you just have these in a straight row, these solar panels max out very early in the day, before the luminosity hits peak. You'll notice there the lux is actually quite high, and this one has been maxed out for quite some time, and these ones right here are pretty close behind it. 380 watts is about the maximum a solar panel can output, and even though these other ones are like half shielded and they can only see almost half shielded, they're still getting close to 380 watts. This allows you to generate the most electricity out of the smallest amount of space. The bigger the pyramids you make, the better, because it allows you to take more advantage of the space. However, what I did was I made this modular, so these eight bunker doors here have 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 have seven solar panels under them. And these eight bunker doors have the exact same thing. So this is basically a copy and paste. You take this design here and basically copy it over here. Now, one downside of solar is, while it's great during the day, the moment it basically drops off the closer you get to nighttime, completely disappears at night and only comes back again during the morning. So it has ups and downs like real solar. So you need some way of actually storing the power when the doors are closed or when it's nighttime. so that you have something to draw on. Now, so that's where we introduce these battery banks. Yeah, so these battery banks are actually pretty straightforward. All the devices in here are generating heat. Every single thing in here generates heat, actually, but it's 11 units of heat. It's half a unit per battery, I believe, and then one unit for the actual power transformers here, or the large power transformers. I placed in three power transformers because I like to actually run multiple devices off these batteries, so that's why I've left them in there. If you don't need to run them, you can, of course, remove them and put in two extra batteries instead. But there is 11 units of heat being generated by these. This wheeze wart in hydrogen, assuming you keep at least 2.2 kilos, I would recommend a minimum of 2.5 kilos, will provide 12 units of cooling, one more than this requires. So this icebox should get cooler and cooler and cooler. I had been dealing with a lot of feature creep at this point, so I haven't min-maxed this design yet, but I just wanted something robust that would last and I would never need to maintain. Now, some people may say, well, you're going to be wasting electricity having this many batteries. True, true. However, if you check out the actual smart battery here, smart batteries have a power runoff of 400 joules a cycle. Using a calculator, I figured it out, it's about, if you had, say, 15 smart batteries in play, they would use the exact same amount of electricity as one ceiling light running constantly, or 10 watts. A ceiling light uses 10 watts, so 15 smart batteries are only using 10 watts. It's minuscule. Power transformers don't even use any electricity. They have no runoff, so there's no actual waste from them. Also, well, smart batteries don't store as much power as jumbo batteries. Jumbo batteries store twice as much power. However, it's 2.5 times as much heat they generate, which means you can't actually put as many into your battery box. Also, their power runoff is much higher. You're better off just using smart batteries. And a piece of advice, I just built in an automation wire on these things just to stop them giving off that annoying symbol. I don't like seeing that on the screen all the time. So, once you've got all of that built, you've made sure that the whole thing's powered, and you'll have to put in some sort of cooling solution here. I'm just using a standard icebox here to power the cooling for the mining drills. Honestly, though, I think you could get away with using a single wheeze wart to cool the mining drills. They're used so intermittently, and they don't gain heat from anything but operation. You don't need a giant solution. Once all that's done, you can then pipe up some oxygen to your telescope, and your duplicants can then start researching planets. Yeah, wonderful. Okay, a couple of features that may not be so obvious to start. One is these mining drills, you don't actually have to place them this close to the surface. If you want to actually, say, farm Regolith, you have some options. Firstly, I've designed this so that you can stick in an auto sweeper right here, and that auto sweeper can actually remove all the Regolith. Like, as long as you put one at every station, it can actually remove all the Regolith that's going to accumulate on top of all these mining drills and around them. However, that said, you can't really make this out of anything but space metals. You need to use nobidium or thermium to make them, because Regolith's 300 degrees. And trying to put in a cooling solution to cool an auto sweeper that's going to be handling material that hot constantly, it's an awful lot of effort. As well as that, you need to put a tile under it to hold a liquid, which reduces the radius of the actual auto sweeper. While at the same time, you then need to actually have some way of preventing Regolith from falling on top of it. It gets awful complicated. You're best off holding off until you get space metals if you want to actually start harvesting this stuff. The rubble that falls down here will not actually interfere with your scanners, your telescopes, or your solar power, so you don't need to worry about it. But if you do want to farm Regolith, these mining drills, you can actually place them. They have a radius of 6 tiles, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So you could put a floor down here instead, and you could actually let 6 tiles of Regolith build up. However, that said, you'd need to actually give 6 tiles of space at the top to let 6 tiles of Regolith possibly accumulate during a meteor shower. But if you do want to farm as much Regolith as possible, if that's your goal at some point, you can actually, yeah, you can definitely use this same design to do that. And with some thermium or nerbidium shipping auto sweepers, you can actually also automate that and maybe run a shovel vol farm. Now, one last quirk of these space scanners. They have many, many, many quirks. It's to do with the automation signal that comes out of them. While they do share scanner data, their detection algorithms, whatever you want to call it, are completely separate. As in, this one might detect the meteors coming in at 200 seconds out, and then this one might not detect them until they're 67 seconds out. Their detection of the meteors is actually independent of each other. While they do boost each other's scattering radius, their detection is completely separate. So this can result in a really annoying problem. You'll notice here I've actually connected both of these together, both of the actual automation networks. That's because what can happen is this scanner will, say, detect the meteors 200 seconds out and go, oh, I'm going to close my doors, at which point it closes its doors, and 40 seconds later the doors are finished closing, and now it's no longer able to scan, which reduces the scanning efficiency of this back down to a possible 34 seconds, which means we've completely defeated the point. So what I like to do here is I actually connect them both together. And these are hooked up to NOT gates. You need to hook them up to NOT gates before the doors so that the signal passes through. So by hooking these two up to NOT gates and making sure it's one continuous automation network, what happens is if this one, say, detects the meteors first, it will send the signal to close the doors. However, that will be overridden by this one, which will say, no, I don't see anything. Keep the doors open. And only when this one actually detects them, or when both of them, it's only when both of them have finally detected that there's meteors coming, will the doors be closed. This makes sure that you always have full scanner quality. And as a bonus, this means that the last scanner to detect them is when the doors are closed, which means your doors will be open for longer, so you'll get more sunlight and you can get more research done. It just works out better. Don't separate them into two separate networks. One thing to note, shovel voles can be quite an inconvenience. For example, you need to leave a two-tile gap to stop them from actually getting from one area to another. For example, I had this gap here to prevent them getting into my battery banks, yet one of them then vomited up a lump of dirt, which it then hopped on top of to then get into my battery bank, which meant I had to crack open the battery bank to remove the shovel vole from it to stop it from dying in there, or, you know, they're annoying. So my advice, always leave a decent amount of space. And what I eventually do is I just put down one metal tile, make sure there's two tiles of a gap around it, and then just dump all the shovel voles on top of it. They can't get out of there. Now, at some point, they'll start dropping eggs, and they'll probably end up on the ground, and I'll have to move them all back, but at least to take care of the problem for a while. Also, wall them in, and I'm probably going to put in two or three layers of doors here just to make sure that they cannot get out. They are very, very annoying. They can't burrow through abyssalite, but don't let them into your meteor. Don't let them get down below the top layer of abyssalite. You do not want them running around in your meteor. You will never catch them again. Also, they have a bit of a weird bug at the moment, or I don't know if it's an accident, but they drop 10 kilos of meat when they die. 10 kilos. Basically, that's five times as much meat as a hatch. So yeah, you can make five barbecues out of a single shovel bowl. So yeah, I'm definitely going to experiment with farming them later, because they seem like they would generate an awful lot of barbecue meat.